Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Night Watch by Tim Akers, narrated by Joe Hempel. Chapter 1. Dragon Slayer. I killed my first dragon with a blunt sword and the engine block of a 1977 Volvo station wagon. It was my mom's car. I don't think she'll ever forgive me, but in my defense, that dragon was a real asshole. This all happened at the fighting competition at my local Renaissance Fair. In case you're not in the nerd know, a Ren Fair is a place that adults go to pretend they're living in the Middle Ages. Full metal armor, overpriced beer and equally expensive steins, some light bard work with a side of bustiers, and a plethora of mud. It's a good time, completely harmless, and the sort of place you might expect to see a frustrated college student living out their dream of being a knight. The thing you shouldn't expect to see is a dragon. Because, and I can't emphasize this clearly enough, dragons aren't real. No more real than wizards or flying carpets or werewolves. No more real than struggling English majors who become actual knights. Or at least, that's what I believed going in. For now, though, I was running late. I was staying with my parents over the summer. My penultimate year in college was going well, but just before the term ended, the apartment I was supposed to live in next year fell through, followed shortly by the job that was supposed to pay for half that apartment and the roommate who was supposed to cover the other half of the rent. It was like the gods were knocking down my hopes and dreams one at a time. Oh, and my girlfriend left me. Cool. Good into a year. Discouraged, I had returned home for the summer. It was kind of weird. I hadn't been home for more than a weekend since I left after high school. I had kept in touch with friends online, and in some ways, it was like stepping back into high school all over again. My old pal Eric welcomed me back into his D&D campaign as if I hadn't missed a session, and the various dramas, traumas, and gossip that I thought I had escaped resumed without missing a beat. The best thing that had come out of this was the local Ren Fair. I used to go every year, but in college I had gotten involved with the statewide fair, a much larger and more professionally run event. But it somehow wasn't as fun as the local deal. I had started fighting again and was quickly moving up the ranks of the tournament scene. That fateful weekend was the regional competition, which would maybe get me back to the state level if I was lucky. Eric was coming along, and he told me he had a surprise waiting at his house.
"Please, God, not another story. Please, God, let it not be another story," I whispered to myself as I gathered my gear.
Eric was kind of a writer, in the way that a thunderstorm was kind of a bath. He produced an endless deluge of elves and heroic farmers and whispering woods that dripped with primeval evil, that sort of thing. And as his friend, and too polite to decline, I had been exposed to all of it. If you have to write 100 bad pages to produce one good sentence, then Eric was well on his way to produce thousands of good sentences. I just hadn't seen any of them yet. "Did your watch stop again?" my mother called from the bottom of the stairs. I whipped my phone out of my pocket and stared at the blinking zeros. I tossed it into my bag. Stupid phone, always flipping out.
"No, Mom," I lied. "My phone is just fine."
"Then you know how late you are?"
"Yes, I know how late I am."
"Because Eric lives 15 minutes away, and you'll need time to park. Use the potty before—"
"Mother!"
"Use the potty before you go, and I don't know how long it takes to get back into your fancy pants after that. But I imagine—"
"Mom, it's fine. I'm just a little late. Eric won't mind."
Mother left her post at the base of the stairs, though I could still hear her grumbling all the way to the kitchen. I tossed the last few supplies into my bag, strapped my sword and shield together, and hurried downstairs.
"Did you eat your snack?"
Mom yelled as I hit the front door.
"Because your tummy—"
I didn't hear the rest of it. I hammered down the stairs to the porch, fumbling in my front pocket for the keys to my little hatchback. Gear went into the back seat. Then I squeezed between my car and Mom's ancient station wagon, carefully opening the driver's side door and shoehorning my way into the car.
14th century, here I come," I shouted and turned the key.
The 14th century was already waiting for me. There are no cars in the 14th century, and there was no working car under my butt. Nothing happened. Not even a whimper from the engine or the clank of a dead starter or anything. Just the click of the ignition and then silence.
I laid my head against the wheel. Okay, I said. Now I'm late. Eric's neighborhood was a little older than mine, a little nicer and a whole lot out of the way. I turned down his street going too fast, the screeching tires of Mom's dilapidated Volvo drawing the stares of a group of mothers on the corner. I queued up my monster manual voice. Beware the feral packs of soccer moms. Disapproving glare plus 10 to hit. Applies the existential horror debuff. You don't look like you're from around here. What are you doing with your life? I rolled past them with a wave. Ladies? They turned back to their strollers in disgust. Eric's house was at the end of the street. Tall trees surrounded the yard, and the main house felt like a forest retreat rather than the suburban mansion that it actually was. I rolled up the driveway and came to a halt in front of his porch. Eric was leaning against the front steps, his iconic beer stein in hand. He was a little heavy, his curly hair sticking out in bits and bobs around the crushed velvet of his barred hat. I had never known Eric to play an instrument, or sing, or show any musical inclination. Yet he insisted on wearing a barred outfit to the fair every year. I think he just liked the tights. Oh, dude, the mom-mobile. What happened to the hot hatch? He asked. I got out of the car, slammed the door like a cannon shot, and shrugged. Wouldn't start. Probably something to do with the ignition or the ultro. Sure, it's definitely one of those things, and not the fact that you break every complicated thing that you touch, he said, bouncing down the stairs and throwing his cooler into the back. My mom's station wagon was the old kind, a Volvo with steel doors as thick as tank armor and an engine that ran on high-grade coal. When Eric slammed the back door shut, it made enough noise to scare a flock of birds out of a nearby tree. Well, it'd get us to the fair. You ready? I asked. They might not like us bringing something this old into a Renaissance fair, Eric joked. He hauled a cooler down the stairs and slid it into the back, along with an authentic loot case that probably contained various grains of vodka and his boots. It strains the realism of the experience. Might want to trade it in for a couple of horses in a wagon. You don't like the ride? You can drive, I said. Nah, it's cool, man, he said, getting into the front seat. Besides, I tore up my license, living old school. Why the hell did you tear up your license? I asked. Historical authenticity, he said, waving his fingers like he was casting a spell. Don't want to mess with the Ren Faire mojo. Oh yeah? And all that gear in the back? I asked, opening my door. How authentic is that Yeti cooler? There is power in anachronism, he answered. And ale. Well, as long as you know what you're... The front door of Eric's house slammed shut, and someone strode out onto the porch. I looked up, and my heart sank. Chessa Lazaro glared down at me from the shadow of Eric's porch. She competed in the archery competition every year, and of all the competitors, she probably leaned into the elf fantasy the hardest. She wore her ears and costume to every match. She spent as much time and money on her outfit as most people did on their wedding gowns, and it showed. This year's version of Elven Warrior Princess was a knee-length armored dress with splint mail leggings and high-laced leather boots trimmed in gold. Light breastplate and shoulders were done in leaf-shaped metal scales, tinted the color of spring grass and also trimmed in milky gold. Her glossy black hair was pulled back in a dozen braids, woven through with golden thread. The tan tips of her fake ears poked through the plates, indistinguishable from her coppery skin. Glittering black paint covered her high cheekbones in a false tattoo that was a cross between a butterfly and a switchblade, hiding the spray of freckles that had first caught my attention years ago. Her eyes, dusty tan with a hint of green, glared at me. We were a thing for 2 weeks the summer before I left for college, and Eric never missed an opportunity to remind me how badly I'd screwed that relationship up. "Leaving without me again?" Chessa asked. "Hey, Chess," I said half-heartedly. "Good to see you." I ducked into the car and lowered my voice. "What the hell, man?" "Surprise," Eric whispered back, his pudgy face framed by jazz hands. Chessa threw her bow and quiver in the back along with a leather pack that looked like it came out of the props department for Elf Wars, Revenge of the Elf Lord. I twisted around in my seat. "You guys are bringing a lot more stuff to this fair than I am," Something I should know? I asked. Chessa sniffed. Eric shrugged. I put the Viking bitch wagon into gear and rattled down the road. The drive to the fair was about as long and awkward as you could imagine. Eric talked about his latest story, which had something to do with mildly erotic tree people and a lot of adjectives. I'm doing some great work with adjectives, he confided to me. Really, really, really great work. When we got to the fair, Chessa disappeared into the crowds. While I was gathering up my gear, I snagged Eric by the elbow. What was that all about? I asked, nodding in Chessa's direction. Are you guys a thing? Holy cow, no. I mean, I would, don't get me wrong. But this... He motioned to his body like he was presenting a movie trailer. This is not the ideal elf body. We've just been hanging out. She's a cool girl. I know she's a cool girl, Eric. That's why she hates me so much. Yeah, well, she needed a ride. Don't make a thing of it. I gathered my gear out of the back of Mom's car under Eric's watchful eye. After I closed the door, he stood there looking at me. He seemed a little nervous. You waiting for something? I asked. He shuffled his feet and pulled something out of his pocket. I got you something. For luck. He handed it to me. It was a kerchief, black with white runes on it. It's a favor. You could tie it to your sword or something. A favor? Are you my lady fair now? No, it's just... It's good to have you home. And I know you're going back to college at the end of the summer, and I'm not sure how many days like this we'll have. So, I thought it'd be nice to have a souvenir or something. I don't know, it felt like something I should do. I was touched. A little creeped out, but touched. I unfolded the kerchief and looked it over. It was... complicated. This something from one of your books? It's the war banner of the Lost Empire of the Mage Witches. Dindaro Danyan the Delft flew it as he rode to war against the inerrant emperor. Eric cleared his throat and continued in a false bardic falsetto. The slick, Icarus, sodden legions plunged, dark and endearing, into the clamoring emptiness of the endless breaking... Right. Got it. I'll do it proud, I said, knotting the kerchief around the hilt of my sword. He smiled. You going to be at the match? You betcha. Wouldn't miss it for this world or the next. He slung his Luto vodka over his shoulder and tipped that ridiculous hat. Good luck in the lists today, Sir John of Rast. Maybe I'll sing to your victory. Please don't, I said, then buckled my sword in place and closed the gate on the Volvo. I have enough trouble without your ballads of woe. Chapter 2. Enter the Hero. I worked my way to the tournament ground, which was tucked into the far side of the fair, past a lot of vendors selling armor, leather corsets, and quite a bit of grilled meat. Usually, I would stroll through, taking in the sights, sounds, and smells of the faux Renaissance. The people were the best part, mostly because they were genuinely, thoroughly happy. A rare thing these days. It was a delightful place. But as I said, I was running late. I could already hear the marshal's call and the reading of the lists. If I didn't hurry, I would miss my place in the tournament. I was competing in single hand and shield, or sword and board as it's known in my circle. I'm not a big guy, tall and skinny and probably too gangly to be graceful, but for whatever reason I'm good with a sword. Call it a gift, or a curse since there's not a lot of demand for expert swordsmen this side of the 16th century. I always felt like I missed my time slot, like I should have been born in an age of knights and castles rather than smartphones and fast food. These tournaments gave me a chance to connect with similarly displaced heroes and spend a weekend forgetting about the disappointing convenience of the modern world. I made some of my best friends at these things. Sometimes I wonder what happened to them all, if they think I'm dead or worse, if I finally gave in to the mundanes and spend my weekends brewing mediocre beer or having opinions about politics. Thank the gods nothing could be further from the truth. Anyway, regionals. I fought my way through the first couple brackets, handling my opponents with ease and honor, never striking when they were down, always letting them reclaim dropped weapons or recover from slippery footing. The chivalry part of this is important to me. You can win and be a dick about it, but that's just a more complicated way of losing. We're grown-ass men and women out in a field hitting each other with wooden swords on the weekend.
Might as well have fun doing it. I did well enough in the initial rounds to earn a place in the finals, then sat nervously on the sidelines while the finalists for two-handed sword, pole arms, acrobatic dagger, and siege bow fought their bouts. The champion for acrobatic dagger caught my eye. She was short and fast, rolling from shoulder to heel and up again, her black braid swirling through the air as she circled her opponent. Acrobatic dagger was supposed to be a combination of throws and dodges, but she never touched her opponent until her padded dagger went into the target on his back. It was a thing of beauty. The audience gave her the round of huzzas that she had earned. Then the marshal marched into the ring and raised his baton. Chessa showed up in the lists for siege bow, but seemed to be off her game. Her initial flight went wide, and she stormed off the range in a huff. She had quite a following among the group of fairgoers who embraced the elven ideal, and was escorted into a nearby grove by a group of pointy-eared cosplayers.
"Sword and shield," the marshal called, and I scrambled to my feet. "For the Duchy of Elderwood, Sir John Rast, champion of the lists, bulwark of...
The marshal peered down at his sheet. Finalists usually had more accolades, but this was my first time in the big ring. The marshal gave up and flourished in my direction.
"Sir John!"
There was a scattering of applause around the ring as I stepped over the barrier.
"Get 'em, John!"
someone in the crowd yelled, and I turned to see my friend Eric raising a stein in my direction. He had a girl on each arm, and three more circling. Typical. Eric was the kind of guy who only seemed truly alive at the fair. Real-world Eric couldn't start a conversation with a girl without preceding it with, "Well, actually," and rarely got to finish his sentence before the lady walked off. Fair-world Eric was witty, constantly surrounded by women, and perpetually drunk. It was something like magic. I waved at him, then turned back to the ring. As my eyes swept the crowd, I caught sight of Dagger Girl. She was leaning against a tree, smirking as she juggled a dagger in one hand. When she raised her brows at me, I realized I was staring and quickly turned away. My opponent was waiting on the other side of the barrier. He wore the bare minimum armor required by rule, preferring to show off the kind of body that a paleo diet and slavish devotion to CrossFit will get a middle-aged man from the suburbs. His shield wasn't much bigger than his fist, while his sword was everything Freud could have wished for. Long and black and as thick as my leg. His chest was heaving, as though he had spent the previous 20 minutes screaming into a shoebox. The marshal waved his baton in the man's direction.
"And for the Outlands, Krasik the Destroyer, champion of the Feral Gods, Reaver of the Black Lagoon, Breaker of..."
The rest of Marshall's introduction was drowned out by Krasik's war cry, a blood-curdling scream that was quickly taken up by a dozen or so similarly dressed followers in the crowd. Krasik raised his compensation unit over his head, then kicked down the barrier and strode onto the field of battle. Remember that thing I said about chivalry? Most folks feel the same way, but not all. Not Krasik the Destroyer, champion of the Feral Gods and extreme phallus rampant. Krasik's real name is Douglas Hosier, and he's a property attorney from the suburbs. He drives a white Camaro, claims to date a Canadian model behind his wife's back, and is fighting a losing battle against a receding hairline. I get the feeling Douglas expected more out of his life than what he's gotten and is channeling that frustration into Krasik. He and his band of emotionally damaged men have been expelled from every duchy and protectorate this side of Cairo, but, being a bunch of lawyers, somehow kept finding a way into the lists. The marshal glared at the damaged barrier, then walked to the center of the ring and raised his baton. We squared off, Krasik's chest still heaving, my hands sweating through the thick padded mittens of my armor. Krasik grinned.
"I'm going to annihilate you, kid. I'm going to beat you so hard your mother's going to be sterile. You'll be running back to... Begin!" the marshal shouted.
Krasik bellowed his disappointment at modern social norms and charged forward. This was normal. Krasik and his type fought linearly, charging or charging faster. I gave some ground, presented my shield, and winced as Krasik chopped at it. There were rules about force of blow, but Krasik always danced the line, a hair's breadth away from disqualification with each attack. He forced me back again,
then slammed his shield into my sword, nearly knocking it from my grip. The tip of his shield caught my hand. The marshal called halt, separating us with his baton. No blows with a shield. A demerit and reset. He swung, I blocked, Krasik growled. What's the problem? The marshal didn't answer. Krasik shook his head and slouched back to the middle. Judge is on your side, little man. Cowards like you, always hiding behind the rules. You've got issues, man, I mumbled. He whirled on me, shaking that ridiculous sword in my face. I do have issues. Screw your issues, that's what.
What?
You know what I mean.
No, I really don't.
You're gonna know. You're gonna remember the might of Krasik.
Right. Yeah, you mentioned that.
I glanced at the marshal. He mentioned that, right? There's not an echo or something?
Taunting, Krasik shouted. Taunting, one demerit.
Demerits are for me to give out and for you to earn, Mr. Hosier, the marshal said primly. Now please reset before I'm forced to disqualify you.
Stupid rules,
Krasik the Hosier yelled. He stomped back to his position, flexed in the manner of a man about to eject his bowels, and shouted,
Krasik!
I was just bringing up my shield to the guard position when a column of fire erupted from Krasik's mouth and slammed into me. The flames curled around my shield, licking at the cheap linen tabard my mother had sewn for me for my birthday. The heat crisped my eyebrows and filled my lungs. I backpedaled, dropping my sword and shaking my shield off my arm. The metal sizzled as it hit the grass, and pain prickled along the length of my forearm. My gloves were ash. I turned to stare at the marshal. There's no way that's legal, I barked. The marshal was staring at Krasik in disbelief. His baton was smoldering, and the shocked look on his face had as much to do with his horror as his lack of eyebrows. Then he turned and ran into the crowd.
You're just gonna... just run? Come on, man! I didn't...
I glanced over at Krasik and shut right the hell up. Krasik was hunched over, with molten fire dribbling out of his mouth. He was larger, and his pale suburban skin was glowing like beaten copper. He tossed his rattan sword to the ground, then rolled his shoulders and looked around.
Krasik's true form has become apparent. Krasik is displeased, he muttered, casting angry looks around at the crowd. Krasik must fix this problem.
Krasik must be on drugs, I said. Seriously, man, get a therapist. You have some stuff that needs resolution. Honestly.
Krasik will start with you, he answered.
He took a step forward, and his boot burst open. Talons spilled out. Scales crawled up Krasik's leg, and his shoulders heaved, splitting open to reveal mucus-slick wings. When he smiled, Krasik's teeth looked like a bandsaw, as sharp and as bright as steel. Flames flickered in his eyes and across his black tongue. I took a step back. Or I'm on drugs. That could be, I muttered. Eric, am I on drugs? A scream went up from the crowd, joined by 100 others, and the grassy field of the St. Luke's Community Soccer Field and Recreational Facility became a stampede. Krasik grew and grew, arms elongating, belly bloating, wings stretching up until they topped the trees. He took a deep breath, and the stink of sulfur and ash filled the air. For some reason, I pulled out my padded dagger, then pissed myself. A blur knocked me aside, sending me flying 10 yards. I landed in a heap on top of the ale stand, breaking through the tent and smashing barrels of overpriced PBR. A flash of light filled the sky, and flames roared over my head. Even with my eyes squeezed shut, I could see blood-red flames. When I opened my eyes, Dagger Girl was staring at me.
Take a knee, mundane. The heroes have arrived, she whispered.
Then she hopped over the smoldering remains of the stand and bounded toward Krasik, toward the dragon. Chapter 3. That Viking Bitch. Dagger Girl hopped across the field, dodging a tail swipe as she ran directly at the beast's gaping maw. The grass under her feet turned to ash as the dragon tried to burn the flesh from her bones. She bounced into the air, executed a mid-leap pirouette, then landed on the dragon's back and started stabbing. The dragon, I thought. What the hell is going on? When the council hears about this, they're going to have a fit. Eric! I shouted. Crowds of people were streaming away, stampeding over the vendor tents and fleeing into the forest at the edge of the field. I caught a brief glimpse of Eric's ridiculous bard's hat as he ducked behind a tree. At least he's safe, I thought. I started in that direction, but my foot caught on something hard and round. It was a skull. It bounced away, chunks of scorched flesh flaking off as it rolled. I put my hands on my knees and threw up, most of it splashing back into my face since my helmet was still buckled down. I ripped the visor off and threw up again, kept at it until my stomach was more than empty. The air sizzled as a stream of flame lashed overhead. It passed 20 feet above me, but the heat singed my nostrils and burned off the bile on my tongue. I spat and looked around. What I saw changed my life. Dagger Girl was dancing around the dragon, the same way she had danced around her opponent in the ring. Krasik, were his scales receding around the crown of his head, followed her, craning his sinuous neck and spraying jets of flame, always missing by inches. He bellowed his frustration, and the trees shook. The girl landed on the dragon's back again, punched down a dozen times in the space of a second, then bounced away. A stream of viscous blood followed her through the air, trailing from the glowing twin daggers in her hands. Krasik's screams changed to pain, and he reared up on his hind legs and stretched his wings to the sky.
Flimsy mortal, Krasik will sear your flesh from your bones and boil your blood in your skull. Flee before the might of Krasik. Flee before the champion of the Outland Realms.
Gotta catch me first, snake face, the girl shouted. She landed in front of the dragon, crouching with both daggers spread wide like wings, that smirk still on her face. You're getting slow in your old age. Slow and stupid.
Respect your elders, child, Krasik said.
His voice hissed through my mind, and flames licked his teeth as he spoke.
I have been in this world longer than any of your kind.
And now you've overstayed your welcome, she answered. Time to go. She leapt forward, but just as her feet left the ground, Krasik poured a stream of fire from his jaws. Twisting, she was somehow able to avoid it, but as she tumbled away, the dragon whipped his massive tail forward, catching her in the back. She flopped like a rag doll, bouncing through the charred grass before coming to a halt. Krasik laughed, crashed back down on all fours, and strolled languidly toward her still form. Oh man, oh man, oh man, I whispered to myself. What should I do? I couldn't just sit here and watch her get killed.
I looked around at the smoldering stalls. The vendor next to the alehouse was a weapon maker. None of the blades were sharp, but they were good steel, and the dragon fire that had destroyed the craftsman's shed hadn't touched them at all. I snatched one of them up and ran at Krasik, waving the sword over my head and yelling,
Hey, you scaly freak! Over here! We haven't finished our match yet, you cheating son of a bitch!
Not my most eloquent taunt, but it served the purpose. Krasik paused and craned his horned head in my direction, then let out a derisive snort that scorched the ground at my feet.
We are not playing games anymore, Sir Berbia. Go back to your foam swords and your weak ale. You have a cubicle to fill on Monday.
I let out a furious roar and charged in. Krasik's wing brushed the air above me, buffeting me, nearly driving me to my knees. But I kept going. His nearest leg rose up. I looked up at those blackened talons, sticky with blood, each one as long as my forearm and wickedly sharp, and I realized I was in over my head.
For Elderwood!
I shouted weakly, my voice cracking as I swung the dull blade against his muscular claw. The steel sang in my hands as it struck scale. The sword snapped in half like an icicle. I stood there, holding the broken hilt, staring at my death. For the second time that day, someone else saved me. A trio of bright arrows blossomed from the dragon's claw. Krasik howled and reared back, thrashing his tail across the soccer field, tearing chunks of sod up with those talons. I staggered to my feet and backed away, Chessa's voice reached me over the din of Krasik's rage. "Get out of there, you moron!" she shouted. I glanced back to see that she stood at the edge of the path that led to the parking lot. God, she was beautiful. What the hell was I thinking, leaving a girl like that behind just to test the waters of single life at college? Let me tell you, those waters are not the kind of place I play with blunt swords on the weekend makes a lot of progress. Maybe I should move home. Maybe I could...
Impudent mortal,
Krasik bellowed, snapping me out of my reverie. I whirled back around and shrieked. There might have been additional pissing. I'd rather not discuss the details. Krasik's claw fell on me, but just as his talons were about to reach my face, a blade of shining steel flashed between us. The tip of the dragon's claw fell to the ground. Krasik shrieked and reared up, beating the air with his wings. A heavy hand fell on my shoulder and pulled me back. A knight, there was no other word, stepped between me and the dragon. He was in full armor, the steel of his plate shining with runes. His double-handed sword blazed with the light of the sun. He looked at me over his shoulder. Get out of here, kid. This is tough enough without trying to keep the idiots alive. I was about to answer when a pillar of flame fell on us from the dragon's mouth. The knight didn't have a shield, but as the fire roared close, a purple dome surrounded us. The shriek of burning air fell hush. I scrambled to my feet, nearly bumping into a black man in exquisite robes carrying a silver staff. Tattoos of light swirled around his left eye, and glowing rings spun above his clenched fist. His pale eyes were fixed on the dragon.
Clarence is correct, he said.
His voice reminded me of a professor, almost too precise, his enunciation as sharp as lightning.
You are no good here. Take your bravery and go home.
I was about to protest when Krasik roared again and another wave of flame singed the air. The knight howled in pain and the mage flinched back. I turned just in time to see the knight, armor still smoldering, run up the dragon's arm and start hacking at Krasik's throat. I ran all the way to where Chessa was standing before I realized it.
Are you an idiot? What the hell are you thinking? She snapped as I ran up to her. You could have gotten killed.
Good point, I said. I grabbed her elbow and pulled her toward the parking lot. Let's go not get killed. Most of the cars had already cleared out, though there were enough smashed bumpers and broken glass in the lot to indicate it had been a hectic retreat. There were dents all along the side of Mom's Volvo, which would have taken some doing considering that the thing was built like a tank. I tore open the door and got in. Chessa dropped into the passenger seat, her complicated costume tangling awkwardly with the belt. She tossed the bow over her shoulder and into the back seat. She started banging on the dashboard.
Go, go, go! This is not how princesses die!
I dug the keys out of the glove compartment, then slammed them into the ignition and twisted. The engine grumbled at me, grating and clanging and sputtering with each turn.
Come on, come on! I shouted.
Stuff broke around me all the time, from cars to computers to expensive espresso machines. Mom wasn't going to be happy when I brought it home with dents in the door. Not like she'll believe the story anyway, I muttered.
Come on, you Viking bitch! Start!
What did you call me? Chessa asked. This is not Viking. This is late Tolkien elf. I don't know how you could possibly confuse the two.
I am talking to the car. The car is obviously a bitch, Chessa. I don't know why I have to explain this.
I kept cranking the key back and forth, pumping the gas, even as we argued. I was about to give up and just run when the engine roared to life. I shouted victory, slammed the door shut, and dropped it into gear. Glass popped under my tires as I backed up out of my spot. Then I cranked the wheel around and lurched toward the exit. I was halfway across the lot when a cacophonous wave of violence swept over the asphalt. An explosion blossomed over the soccer field. I couldn't see what was going on over the berm, but I could hear screaming and Krasik's hideous laughter. The tips of his wings fluttered through the air and bright, blinding flame washed across the field. The screams got louder and worse.
Holy Idrisil, Chessa breathed. I had no idea it was going to be like this. I had no idea, I swear.
This is well outside the bounds of your usual Renfair experience, yes, I said. I slammed on the brakes and stared toward the field, fingering the transmission.
What are you doing? John, what are you doing? Ah, to hell with it, I muttered. Chessa, get out. No. You're going to do something stupid, and then it's going to be my fault for not stopping you. You're just trying to impress me, and I've got to tell you, it's not going to work. You're not a hero, John. Maybe today I am. Now get out. She stared at me for 3 long seconds, then fumbled the seatbelt off and rolled out of the car. She slammed the door shut and leaned down to the open window. Boys are idiots. Yup, I said. Then threw the car in reverse, spinning the station wagon's balding tires as I spun around. Can't take the car home in this condition anyway. I pointed the hood toward the walkway that led to the fields, pulled the seatbelt across my shoulder with one hand while I steered with the other, and floored it. There was a barrier to prevent this very thing from happening, but it was made to stop ambitious suburban parents from driving their precious German SUVs onto the sidelines, not to stop a chunk of Viking metal at top speed. I crashed through the barrier, slewed back and forth on the loose gravel of the path, then reached the field. The shocks bottomed out in the drainage ditch, and for a brief moment I was airborne, flying like a Valkyrie toward the dragon and destiny. I planted the nose in the mud, sawed the wheel back and forth as the tires bit into the sod, then lay into the accelerator and started screaming. The heroes were in a bad way. The night was down, and Dagger Girl was on fire as she danced away from the dragon's claws, bloody rents in her leather armor and desperation in her eyes. The mage, if that's what he was, knelt beside the fallen knight. There was blood coming from his eyes. He turned and looked at me, his eyes going wide and white as I barreled toward him. Then he grabbed the knight and rolled out of my path. The dragon heard me at the last second. He was focused on the girl and her shining daggers and gave no thought to an engine roaring ever closer. Not until it was too late. Krasik swung his sinuous neck toward me, wide head just off the ground. His golden eyes flashed wider for just a second, and flames curled around his jaws as he breathed in, ready to obliterate me, Mom's Volvo, and the everything in between. I put the hood of the car into his jaw, going about 40 miles an hour. The front of the car crumpled, and I was thrown against the seatbelt, hands smashing the wheel as my head snapped forward like a whip. I saw the hood erupt and the engine, old and heavy and still spinning, shoot out of its moorings and through the dragon's skull. The dragon's teeth shattered like delicate china. The black slug of the engine tore through Krasik's head and punched out the other side, taking whatever suburban frustration and mystical wisdom a dragon posing as a property lawyer might contain along with it. The dragon's neck whipped through the air like a fire hose, spewing molten flame across the field. He deflated, scales shuffling to the ground, wings withering like spiderwebs in the wind. Then he dropped to the ground and was still. With numb fingers, I snapped the seatbelt off, shoved open the crumpled door, and got out of the car. The two people still standing stared at me with open shock. I tried to wave, lost control of my arm, my shoulder, and then my legs, following my hand to the ground. I lay there for what seemed like a long time, breathing in scorched grass and wondering if the ringing in my head would ever stop. A shadow fell across my face. I looked up and saw the mage and the girl staring down at me. The girl looked furious.
"Who is this guy?" the mage asked.
"An idiot," she said. Then she turned away and ran to the fallen knight. The mage leaned over.
"Even idiots can be heroes," he said.
He pressed his palm against my forehead. There was a bright scarlet light, and then nothing. I woke up in a very different kind of place. Chapter 4. Mundane Actual. The first thing I smelled was mildew and antiseptic. When I opened my eyes, the dim light of a pair of candles flickered over stone walls and a white ceiling, spotty with water stains and mold. I coughed, and the sound echoed. I tried to sit up, but the sheets wrapped around my shoulders were as tight as a straitjacket and just as comfortable. I took a deep breath and was alerted by my nervous system that I was actually in a lot of pain. Maybe enough pain to kill me. Certainly enough to keep me still and whimpering for the immediate future. So I continued to whimper. This drew the attention of my attendant.
"So, not dead then,"
The speaker appeared to my right, nothing more than a dim shape in the candlelight. He tucked some bit of restrictive sheet even tighter around my shoulders, then leaned in close. I was surprised to see he was wearing a pair of vintage sunglasses, the kind with thick black plastic frames and lenses as black as midnight. Long, curly brown hair spilled out on either side of his face. He was dressed in a dingy white blazer and blue jeans. He tapped my forehead. "That's a pity. We could use another dead guy around here."
"Where am I?" I croaked.
My throat was as dry as uncooked rice. Mr. Coolshades went to a nearby table and returned with a stein of water, then slowly poured it over my face. I gasped for breath, getting more of it into my lungs than my belly, while the rest soaked into my sheets.
"What the hell?"
"You're in mundane actual," he said, and you could hear the capitals. He returned the metal cup to the table. Both it and the candelabra on the table looked like props from the Renaissance fair. "This is as far as we can take you for now." "Not a hospital? I feel like I should be in a hospital." Cold fear crept into my gut. "Am I being kidnapped?"
"Maybe. Or maybe you're dead. We'll get into that later."
He leaned against the table and folded his arms. Now that my eyes were adjusting to the light, I thought I could see a dim glow behind his shades, as though his pupils were burning.
"It's really an interesting question, about free will and our right to choose what the universe may have already picked out for us. Did you stop having a choice when you drove your wagon into our friend's face? Or was it sooner? Or later? Or are you making choices at all? See, in the 16th century..."
"Enough of that, Matthew," a familiar voice said.
The man I thought of as the mage appeared at my feet. I mean that literally. He wasn't there, then he was.
"I'm sure our guest has enough issues without your existential rambling. How are you feeling, son?"
"Like I was in a car crash with a dragon, then tied up and left to die of thirst? So, you know, pretty great."
"Oh, you're thirsty?" Matthew asked. He turned back to the table. "You should have said something."
"Why did you pour water on my head?"
"Why would I pour water on your head if you were thirsty?" he asked.
"Exactly."
"I don't think I understand your question."
He presented the cup again, holding it next to my shoulder. I looked from it to his face, then to the mage.
"Matthew," the mage said, "he can't very well take that cup from you if his hands are tied, can he?"
"Right, right. Mundane. I forget."
He jerked the sheets free of my chest, setting off a whole new round of misery and pain. I had a moment to stare at the cuts and bruises across my chest before the pain hit me, and then I wasn't very thirsty for a while. When my senses returned, I carefully levered up onto my elbow and took the cup. The water was cold and stale, thick with silt. I almost spat it out, but my dry throat demanded otherwise. As I was gulping down the last of the water, a lot of stuff clicked in my head. Dead bodies on a field, and my friends disappearing into the woods. "I have to go," I said, trying to stand. The mage made no effort to stop me. He didn't need to. Gravity and the pain in my chest were enough. I settled back on the bed.
I have to find out what happened to my friends, to the people at the park."
"A lot of them died," the mage said simply. "But not so many we can't fix it. With the news, that is. Dead is still dead, even here."
"Oh, God. Oh, hell," I said. I was starting to feel sick again. "Do you know if my friends made it out?"
"Who were they?" he asked. "We're compiling a list for the media teams so they can start on direct contact. If you have their names..."
"Eric Cavanaugh and Chessa Lazaro. They were dressed like...
"Elves. The girl, at least. We've had our eye on her for a while."
The mage stood up and pulled a small notebook from his robes, then conjured a pen of pure light and wrote in it. I was still staring when he snapped the book shut.
"She's fine. But we're not sure about Eric. Cavanaugh, you say? I'll have the cleanup crews look into it."
"Cleanup crews? Media teams? These are people we're talking about. People who have died."
"Yes, I understand the concept. I wouldn't worry just yet. Some of them we can retrieve, Their bodies might not yet believe they're dead, and then it's just a matter of talking the flesh back into the game. Like I said, we're still compiling the lists. I'm sure your friend will show up. And while we're at it... He lifted the notebook again. What's your name? The mage asked.
John. John Rast, I said. What's yours?
Sir John Rast? So you gave your actual name to the lists. He made his note and tucked the book away with a smirk. Don't most folks make up something more interesting?
I'm as interesting as I need to be, I said defensively. Truth was, I couldn't come up with anything better. What's your name? Merlin? Gandalf? Tim?
Furaha Nanguvu Yatembo, he said simply. Or is that too interesting for you?
Few Harry Na Tembo for your lazy American tongue. Fair enough, Tembo, I said, then swallowed more water and held the cup out to be refilled. Matthew just stared at it for a while. I looked at him. Is there more?
Yes, he answered, genuine confusion in his voice.
May I have some, or is there some special way of asking for water in this place? Tembo took my hand and guided the cup back to my mouth. It was full again, and I realized the table didn't have a pitcher on it. Bile burned through my throat. I dropped the cup and rose to my feet, ignoring the pain in my chest. The sheet fell to my knees, and I was thrilled to discover that I was completely naked and not doing a lot for my reputation, considering the cold and injuries. I snatched the sheet up around my armpits, ignoring the stabs of pain in my chest, and stood there, shivering. Seriously, what the hell is going on? I snapped. There was a dragon, and those lights, and the girl with the daggers, and a dragon. Do you have any idea?
Yes, yes, we know we were there. Tembo held up one hand like he was arguing politics with a drunk relative rather than discussing the particulars of a dragon on a suburban soccer field. He put a gentle hand on my shoulder and pushed me down onto the bed. I think that's enough weird stuff for one day.
No, you're not going to put me to sleep again, buddy. I want some answers and...
I doubled over in pain as something tore loose in my chest. I leaned against the bed and tried to breathe. When the agony had passed, I continued.
Scratch that. No answers. I don't need to know what sort of nonsense you're up to. I just want to go to a nice, normal hospital with nice, normal doctors and boring cups that don't fill themselves.
That would be foolish, Matthew said patiently. You're in the best hospital in the world. In all the worlds. Besides, we've got some questions for you and your friend.
Questions for me? For me. What on earth could you possibly want to ask me?
I had forgotten how curious mundane conversation can be. What on earth indeed? On earth, Matthew chuckled and rubbed his thigh, then seemed to lose track of the conversation as his palm chafed the blue leg of his pants. Man, I miss jeans. Later, Tembo said. For now, one more weird thing, and then you promise to stay calm until we can get our boss down here, okay?
Hospital or I start screaming, I said. I don't care where this is, someone's going to hear me.
Sir John, you have no idea, Tembo said. He pinched the bridge of his nose in frustration, then motioned to Matthew. Saint Matthew, ease this man's pain, will you? You're sure? I've only got so much, and Clarence... Clarence will be fine once we get him back to his domain. Esther hates it when she has to spend the first part of an interview convincing a mundane that the world really is an interesting place. Our friend needs a little persuasion.
Sure thing, Tim, Matthew said.
He whipped his sunglasses off. The light I had seen through the shades before wasn't fire at all. His eyes shimmered like the sparkle that comes off diamonds in those jewelry store commercials, the purest, most unbelievable light. He held his hands forward, palms up, leaned his head back and closed his eyes. The shimmer lingered, then flared into brilliance. Pure light washed over me, filling me with warmth and hope and comfort. I collapsed back onto the bed. My pain was gone. The skin on my chest was smooth.
the scabs gone, and whatever had been grinding in my ribs was replaced with a comfortable warmth. When I sat up, there was no discomfort. Not even my muscles ached, and the mottled purple bruises where the seatbelt choked me had disappeared. I stared down at my hands in wonder. "What did you do?" I asked.
"You might call it a miracle if you're that type," Matthew said.
He folded the sunglasses and put them in his pocket. The light in his eyes was gone, replaced by dull brown irises and bloodshot whites.
"That's all I've got, Tim. Clarence will have to wait until we get across the threshold. I need to get back to the brilliance, spend some time with the light before I can heal anyone else."
"You couldn't have done much for him with that little radiance anyway," Timbo said, nodding grimly.
He motioned toward the door. Matthew clapped my shoulder, then turned and left. The mage settled onto the edge of my bed.
"Is that proof enough?" he asked.
"Proof of what?"
"Impossible things. There are going to be a few of them from here on out. I can't really say more than that, not until the boss gets here."
I looked down at my hands, flexing the fingers, rolling my wrists. I was healed. I nodded my head. "Sure," I said. "That's proof enough." "So who's the boss?"
"I'll let her do the introductions. For now, simply know that you and your friend are lucky to be alive and not in chains. Took some convincing to keep Bethany from filling you full of holes. Clarence spoke well of you. Of your bravery, at least, if not your ability."
"Wait," I said, his words finally settled on me. "My friend? Is Eric here?"
"I do not think that girl would answer to the name Eric," Timbo answered. "She seemed quite keen to know if you were hurt, though I'm not sure that's to your benefit."
"Ah," I said, and the bottom dropped out of my stomach. "Chessa."
"Great."
Chapter 5. Feral Janitors. After Timbo and Matthew left, I took the time to explore the room I was in. I wouldn't usually use the word explore in this context, but this was definitely an exploration. There was a worryingly large pile of bloody towels at the foot of my bed. I pushed them around with my toe, trying to decide if it was enough blood loss to cause hallucinations. Maybe, maybe not. I snatched up the candelabra and started into the darkness away from the door. Turns out I was in a long, dark hallway with beds every 15 feet and no windows. The light from the candelabra never gave me more than 5 feet of illumination, and the farther I got from my own bed, the dimmer the candle's flame grew. I went until the wick was a dim glimmer, then turned back. The hallway could have gone on forever, for all I could tell. It certainly went for 100 feet. With the uncertain void stretching out beside me, I found it difficult to sleep, despite Timbo's warnings about the rigors ahead. I finally settled into a restless doze, my mind running through the events of the day, the impossibility of dragons, and the strange man with the glowing eyes. There were a lot of weird things going on, and my mind was reeling. But mostly I was worried about Eric and Chessa. Eric because he was my friend, and Chessa because she wasn't, and I wasn't looking forward to having to explain what had happened. Especially since I didn't really know what had happened, or where we were, or anything. Maybe she would have some answers. Hopefully. I was sleepily mulling the possibility of slipping out before my interview with this boss person when the door opened, and two nondescript men in gray coveralls came in. I heard their voices before the door opened, and they sounded perfectly normal, which made their arrival all the more shocking.
"There were three of them, big as dinner plates, just scuttling around behind the fridge. Dinner plates, Mike."
The speaker was short and thin, his head and hands too large for his body, dressed in gray coveralls. His companion was nearly his twin. The light from the outside hallway blinded me for a second as they came into the room. There was something wrong with their hands.
"So, being the kind of man that I am, and not the kind of man you are, I got the Zippo out of the garage." "Gods, Jerry, you're a wreck," the other man said.
I sat squinting up at their dim forms as they busied themselves at the foot of my bed.
"A Zippo? For roaches?" "Roaches the size of dinner plates, Mike. Keep your eye on the fine details of the story.
Never step on anything larger than your foot, my mom always said. Zippo it is.
But still,
Mike bent down, briefly disappearing beneath the bed.
Your mom lived in a swamp. Not much danger in setting everything ablaze when...
You are keen to recognize the danger of my position, Mike. Keen indeed. But there was nothing for it. The roaches had drawn the wrath of Jerry left. I dialed the Zippo to what was surely an appropriate setting, primed the wick, and set about purging my kitchen of this nightmare. Have you ever burned a roach, Mike?
Mike made a gagging sound, which drew a chuckle from Jerry.
Popcorn, my friend. Their shells erupt in the most satisfying way you can imagine. Of course, the refrigerator defrosted in an explosive manner, but at least the melted ice put out the lingering flames from the cabinets. All according to plan.
Excuse me, I tried to interject.
Jerry waved his hand at me dismissively. A moment, boy, never interrupt a good story.
This doesn't feel like a good...
I screamed. Screamed, you understand, because I finally saw what was wrong with their hands. Jerry gestured at me, not with fingers or palms or knuckles, but with something that could have been mistaken for a mop made of octopi, purple-black tentacles squirming over shining beaks, suckers puckering open and closed. So I screamed. Reasonable. Jerry turned pale white in the blink of an eye, and the sudden contrast revealed the rest of his form, which was boring in a comfortable way. He put a perfectly normal human hand to his chest, breathed in sharply, and blinked at me in shock. His other hand, the left hand, squirmed into a tight ball like spaghetti around a fork.
Son of a bitch! Jerry finally squeaked out. What's wrong with you? What's wrong with you?
I echoed, pulling myself upright and drawing the sheets around my shoulders.
With your hand!
Mike said as he stood up. Several bloody towels were hanging from his mouth, and his throat was distended with the rest of the pile. He stared at me in confusion. There was more screaming, more confused hand and tentacle waving on the parts of Jerry and Mike. Mike's right hand was a match to Jerry's left, otherwise the two appeared to be twins. And finally, an unfortunate retreat from the bed that ended with me getting tangled in the sheets. I fell onto the stone floor in a heap.
Will you stop that?
Jerry shouted at me. He and Mike were both on top of the bed, clutching each other and mincing their feet.
They startle very easily.
They? I asked. They who?
Left and right,
Jerry answered. He held out his grotesque hand. It was nearly normal size, the tentacles wound tightly together and two large eyes with figure-eight pupils staring out at me.
I've been through one evacuation. I don't want to do that again.
Hadn't flinch,
Mike mumbled around the towel in his mouth. He distended his jaw, worked his throat, and drew the rest of the towel into his belly. His skull reassembled itself, and he wiped his blood-flecked lips.
I mean a real serious bitch.
What is happening to my life?
I pressed the heels of my palms into my eyes, rubbing colors and shapes into the darkness, until I remembered I was naked and alone with two men who ate laundry and had tentacles for hands. When I opened my eyes, they were still staring at me, tentatively.
Are you done screaming? Jerry asked.
I don't think I'll ever be done with it, no. But I don't think there are screams enough in the world to cover this situation, so... I stood up, wrapping the sheets around my waist.
What the hell is going on now? Are you the boss?
Oh, gods, no,
Mike said with a disturbing smile.
Gods, the boss. Ha! I mean really big, ha!
His laughter sounded like something he practiced in the mirror, right along with that smile.
No, we're just the janitors. The tame ones, not the other ones.
There are feral janitors? Where do you think the smells come from? Jerry asked, matter of fact.
What?
Never mind. Never freaking mind. What do you want? Jerry pointed to Mike's belly.
The towels, of course. And that sheet, frankly, you've made quite a mess out of it.
Well, the sheet is all I have to wear right now, so... Jerry interrupted me with a sinuous hand wave, then produced a pair of coveralls much like their own, only black. He set them on the bed.
Now the sheet, if you please.
Some privacy? I asked. Turn around, or something.
We have a lot of eyes, Mike answered. There wouldn't be much point in it, though if it makes you feel better.
Nope, no, never mind. I don't want to know about your eyes. Just wait outside. I'll throw the sheet out when I'm done.
We're supposed to take the sheet with us, Mike said.
He rubbed his belly, looking nervously at Jerry.
He could run away with it.
I'm not going to steal your... my life. What is...
never mind.
I picked up the coveralls and started unfolding them. There was a patch on the chest, an elongated hexagon that resembled a Templar's helm, but with an ankh instead of a cross. As I pulled them on, I noticed Jerry and Mike wore a similar patch on their shoulders. With some clever balancing, I was able to get the coveralls on without completely abandoning my decency. I threw the sheet at Mike.
Happy? We were supposed to wash him, Mike said nervously.
Nope. No. Get out. Go and keep going until you're far away. Both of you, go. I hustled the janitors out the door, then sat down on my bed and wondered about, well, a lot of things. When Timbo came through the door a few minutes later, I was perched on the edge of my bed, about to burst.
I know I've asked this before, and I know I'm starting to repeat myself, but you have to understand my position. This is weird, all of this, and maybe it's not so strange to you, considering your whole light tattoo, interesting name, silver staff deal, but I'm starting to freak out, so can you please, seriously, please tell me what the hell is going on?
Unfortunately, I said all of this in one breath, too fast for the words to properly form. Timbo raised his eyes at me.
Pardon? He asked.
That's really all I've got. It's a lot of little things or big things, but it would take too long to list them all.
You know all this isn't normal, right? So answer my question. What is going on?
A good question, but one without a single answer. Usually, by this point in the initiation...
Initiation? Like a cult?
You're a cult, then. Listen, you're going to get yourself worked up. Just come with me.
No, I have not gotten myself worked up. If anything, I have gotten myself worked down, which is kind of a big deal considering what I've been through. Two guys with squids for hands have gotten me worked up. They wanted to wash me, Tim. They didn't have buckets, Tim, or water, or normal hands, Tim.
The janitors can be disconcerting, an unfortunate offshoot of some early 20th century writing that got out of hand. Most of them are friendly, but a few...
He shrugged.
Anyway, I thought you would still be asleep when they arrived.
How is that better? Why do you think it would be better for me to wake up to that?
They exude certain chemicals that, upon contact with the skin, send the victim...
How is that better, Tim?
Enough shouting. The boss is waiting for you. Are you comfortable?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.